At Extreme Clean, we understand your home is your most important investment. From carpet to tile and grout cleaning, we handle it all. Call Extreme Clean now to schedule 221-6440, extremecleannm.com. At Extreme Clean, we understand your home is your most important investment. From carpet to tile and grout cleaning, we handle it all. Call Extreme Clean now to schedule 221-6440, extremecleannm.com.
Sinners and Saints, a proud sponsor of Pro View Sports and New Mexico Youth Athletics. Start your evening off right with a delicious menu selection like the Sinners Smothered Fries with pulled pork and green chili. Always prepared with fresh, never frozen ingredients. Catch all the sports action from college pros and MMA on one of our 35 HD TVs. Sinners and Saints, the friendliest sports bar in Albuquerque.
Don't forget, every Pro View Network sporting event is on sale at our DVD store. Go to www.proviewnetworks.com to buy your DVD today.
Hey, welcome to the Steve Davis Show. Special guest today is Gerard Pernotta, head baseball coach at La Cueva High School. And Gerard, thanks for coming on. It's been a while. I mean, it's good that. And then I want to congratulate you on being the 2017 Metro champions. And I know those blue shirts mean a lot. And
the kids.
Besides being blue on blue, so.
Yeah, the kids are talking about getting that shirt here all last week. And again, thanks for having me on. And hopefully we have a team to talk about and continue to talk about for the rest of the season.
Well, not only do you have a team, but you're going to catch me up on the baseball world, because for the last 2 weeks I've been in the basketball mode, and I'm looking at it. I even told you, as every time I do a baseball coach or get into baseball, I just feel so guilty because the season's almost half over. I mean, this week you're halfway done through their season.
Yeah, it goes really quick. To imagine that we're 9 games in and I haven't even felt like we've been able to really get guys going. Getting some guys playing time and getting them ready for the season, it just sure seems like we're well into it, and we're trying to get a lineup finalized and get to our set lineup, and running out of opportunities to get other guys experience and playing time. But it goes quick.
One thing, with that being said, and I understand what you're saying, and I've talked with enough baseball coaches. I played baseball, and I'm not an X's and O's and the strategy, but I've watched over the last 10 years of doing Pro View Networks, I've watched and talked with coaches you may throw somebody early and may even lose a game just to see where that person is. You don't go in and try to lose a game. Yeah. You're testing somebody. He's been doing good in practice. He's been good here, and you're going to give him this little shot to see if he can do something.
Yeah, exactly.
Because later in the season, when it comes to you need 3 pitchers that can perform, and if you don't give them the reps or to give them the confidence.
Yeah. Exactly, and it goes back to basketball. I know you're a big basketball guy. We're a heck of a player, and coach quite a bit. That when you get those guys, you try to get to your 6 or 7 man rotation by the end of the season. But you got to get some guys playing time, and so early on with pitchers and pitch counts and moving some guys around. That's obviously what we're trying to do here during this pre-district schedule. And you don't want to drop many games because
of the selection.
Exactly.
It's especially in a short basketball is a little different because it's 5 months.
Right.
And you're looking like almost it's a 3 month. And
right.
You're done. 3 months and you're gone.
It's about 3.5 if you're lucky. When you including the month of February, which is all practice. It's first of February to the middle of May, hopefully, and you're playing at Isotopes Park on May 13th.
I mean, that's the goal of La Cueva, and I think that's the goal of every coach is to get to that. And you said the word isotopes. I mean, how nice is that to play? I mean, for your fans, your school, and also your players, and also your staff.
It's an incredible atmosphere. You've been fortunate enough to play there several times, and the facility obviously is outstanding. The surface is outstanding. But just that environment and the excitement that playing there creates. You know, we've played a couple games, state tournament games at UNM, and a couple state tournament games at least one at Rio Rancho. And you know, it's a state tournament game. It's got that feel, but it doesn't have quite the same energy as when you get to walk down those steps at Isotopes Park.
Well, and you said that, you know, from the press box we're up high and looking down on the field, and it's, I don't think it's so immaculate. I mean, they take so good care of it. And I mean, there's no room for excuses for the field being in bad shape, man. I mean, you know that you better be. The ground might be too fast, and the distance. I think that's the biggest thing when you go to the Isotopes Park is the distance, teaching
right
where to place people.
You know, we even talked about that in the Metro Championship when we moved over to UNM this last weekend. You know, have to remind our outfielders, that to play in relationship to the infield versus, I think oftentimes when kids go to a bigger park, they play in relationship to the wall. And, you know, I play this far from the wall at La Cueva, and this is where I'm going to play now, and you just get caught too deep. And then if you can swing the bats, which we were able to do a little bit, and you can shoot a ball in that gap, it's almost a guaranteed triple when you get into those big parks.
Well, here's the one. I'm giving you a code. Here's what I do know about the Isotopes Park. It was probably, I think it was like 4 or 5 years ago, and I think El Dorado was playing. Anyway, the wind was blowing.
Oh yeah.
And it was blowing kind of strange. It was blowing from the east to the west.
Yeah.
You know, okay, so you have the protection, and I was like. Watching the pregame, and I'm a big on basketball pregame and doing things,
right.
You know, getting kids associated, because you know basketball's, you know, lighting, you know, if you're playing the pit, depth
right.
Perception, almost the same thing you're saying.
Yeah.
But I was watching the ball go up, and the wind would catch it and move it maybe even 20, 30 feet, and I was like. I wanted to go down on the field and tell them, would you hit some high balls up where the players can get used to, you know, trying to judge the wind? Because,
right.
And sure enough, during that game, like 3 or 4 balls were missed because the wind would catch it and it would go 20, 30 feet from one way or the other.
You know, it gets to be real deceiving. I think we had a game like that at Isotopes.
And maybe it was even you. So I just.
And so you get a little bit. Caught off guard because since it sits a little bit down, you know, the surface, the field level, you don't quite feel some of that at the field
wind,
level.
Right.
But, you know, and when it gets up, especially, and you start getting it in off the mountain when it does come that way on occasion, you know, and that's, you think it's going up, and then when it gets higher, it catches the wind and it moves it quite a bit. So I remember a game like that we actually misplayed a couple balls.
Maybe it was you. I just remember, I was like, but I was watching pregame, and nobody was hitting high balls up. Just, you know, I mean, they were hitting
right.
You know, line drive. I'm sitting there going, would somebody just please just hit one up and let them see how far this thing is going to carry? And I think, and also the, you know, would listen to Tom Dragmaster, which is probably, you know, a good friend of yours, a good
yeah.
friend of sports, I mean, good friend of everybody's. When he talks baseball, is talking about, you know, that when that wind blows, it's amazing how much it does carry. I mean,
yeah.
you get it up, and it was like, and I think there was, in the game that I watched, I think there was some long balls hit that probably wouldn't have been long balls they were hitting, and they just kept going and kept going. And when I see the ball hit, I'm usually looking at two things. One, I look at the pitcher, and I always look at the coach. I like to look at the coach, and because you have an idea when it goes off the bat if it's gone or not.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's kind of like a basketball player when he shoots a three or something like that. He knows, he already knows, and the coach knows. And all the players know that it's going
to
go in.
Yeah, I like watching, especially now during the tournament. Those guys at the end of the bench when that 3-point goes up, and those guys are getting off the bench and onto their feet because they've got that feeling that it's going.
Well,
in.
Baseball has the same. I mean,
oh, yeah.
It's the same thing when it comes off the bat. You know, and even I know it's something that. you know, even your the guy, which you don't want happening, you don't want him thinking that he just hit a home run because you want him to run the bases. But even they kind of know when it comes off that bat a certain way that it's over that fence.
Yeah, it's that good feeling. You know, you kind of like with your driver when you square up a driver on the golf course and.
Yeah, I haven't had that feeling, I haven't had that feeling yet. All right.
Well, when you do, Steve, you'll know it.
Okay. So when you hit that sweep, I haven't found that spot yet. So I'm just that's why I still go out and practice. I keep hearing about that thing, but it hasn't quite got there yet.
We'll have to give out sometime. But yeah, it's you know those guys and they've played the game so long and they know, and you know just like any kid that plays at a high level in any sport, they've put so much time in that we talk a lot about feel and how it feels off the bat. And yeah, they've got a good idea of when they really need to hoof it down the line and when they think they've got one.
You know, kind of going back to this earlier statement about, you know, when to play players, when not, you know, when to bring, you know, being a, you know, a young guy in, get him some hits, and also win, which is the fine line of it all comes together, and maybe even a loss may win you a game later on because sometimes as we both know is that players sometimes can't be coached until they either mess up and been in that environment.
Right, you know.
I mean, we can talk about it, but when you're then you and I both know it. Hey, well, all right, now let's go back to what I was talking about in pitching practice or batting practice or running or you know some you know running plays or details of playing the game for seven innings.
Yeah, you know, and we kind of ran into that a little bit already when we dropped our opener to Valley 5-3 and. You know, and the guys, I think they went in with that expectation of winning, and we want to have that expectation to win every time we step on the field. But, you know, then there's all the things that go into having that outcome be as you want it. And, you know, we've played with a different kind of mentality since we dropped that, and our energy level, you know, has been really good for the most part the whole year. And I think you're exactly right. You know, they sometimes believe their press clippings or what other people tend to say about them, and then you kind of get punched in the mouth a little bit, and you're like, okay.
If it's gonna be a good thing to get punched, first game's a good one to get punched in, man. Or because if you win and they're not doing right, it's because you're just better athletically. Then you're not. But you got punched in the face a little bit. And so, Gerard, we're going to go to the Dave and Buster's Top 10 Plays of the Week and then come back and talk more of La Cueva baseball.
Sounds good.
We'll be right back.
Visit the Frontier Restaurant. Due to heavy construction on Central, take lead or coal coming north or south. The Frontier Restaurant. Get your Frontier fix on. Don't forget, every ProView Network sporting event is on sale at our DVD store. Go to www.proviewnetworks.com to buy your DVD today.
Altitude Sports Grill is where Albuquerque's sports fans won't miss a game. With locally crafted brews on tap and refreshingly crisp cocktails. Located in Hotel Cascada, Albuquerque residents find a staycation worth staying for. Catching Lobo Sports, enjoying a beer on the beach, or wiping out, Hotel Cascada is home to your urban adventure. Affordable guest rooms, no-hassle water park parties, and much more.
Graphic Connection is your source for quality custom sports apparel inspired by the athletes that wear it. Graphic Connection offers in-house graphics, embroidery, digital printing, and screen printing, enabling us to offer custom products with fast turnaround to suit both your budget and your timeline. Graphic Connection is New Mexico's exclusive Cornet digital garment printer shop. The print resolution is unparalleled. Contact Graphic Connection today at 505-821-2777 or visit us online at www.gcsportswear.com.
Hey, welcome back to the Steve Davis Show. We got Gerard Pinato, head baseball coach at La Cueva High School. And hey, Josh, that was pretty neat with that baseball. You just put that in there today. I mean, I mean, you caught me. I thought the ball was going to hit me in the face on that one there. So that was a good little twist there. So, but anyway, you got a wake up call first game, and I know every coach, every player. I mean, that's expectations coming out. You've been working, you've been playing, you get that game. And so what was the mind attitude at that time?
Well, you know, I knew it was a possibility.
And Bowdy is, Coach Kuhn is a rival. You're his target, beat La Cueva. I mean, that's a great target to have. I mean,
yeah.
He came in. And
well, and like I said, I thought it was a possibility. You know, I knew they had that left-handed pitcher, from last year that was throwing the ball well and had the potential to throw the ball really well. And he did a great job. I mean, I don't think he walked walked any of our guys, and he threw two pitches for strikes. He threw the fastball on the inside half of the plate, commanded both sides of the plate, and then threw a second pitch for a strike. So he was going to be tough to beat that day. And so we were hoping if we could have kept it just a little bit closer, because we had some opportunities in the seventh, especially when they went to the bullpen. But yeah, Coach Kuhn does a great job and had his guys prepared, and I hope that people have that reaction when they beat us, because if they ever stop having that reaction, then maybe we've lost a little bit of our luster. But
well, you know what? You're right. I mean, but that's a good. That's who you are, and that's who the school La Cueva is. That's what you. I mean, that's what you're. I mean, I take this as a compliment. That's what I mean.
Yeah.
First thing when I look at I apologize. I mean, I say this every year when I talk to my first baseball game, is that, these last 2 weeks for me has been. I can't even watch the NCAA basketball, because it's I've watched so many basketball games. I've called so many basketball games, but
I was telling Scott. I saw Scott out there at UNM on Saturday. I was amazed he even had a voice, and you guys the same, because what, 84 games, and then all the prep work and the side work and preparation.
Well, think about Scott. I mean, just for a second, I don't even know. He went on the road
with UNM,
and he did two or three games on the road. He drove all night on the bus, got in, and then at 8 o'clock he was doing ESPN. I think he did eight games at ESPN, and then he went and did the Gladiators.
Did he? I didn't realize that.
On Saturday night, and again, I look at this, and here y'all are. They go, well, nobody gives us any love. But I'm just the reality of it is, it's and we're Well, we're going to make up for that over the next 4 or 5 weeks. But
and then you do the same thing for state baseball. So it's all got its seasons and its timing. And, you know, I know you guys do a great job, and the kids are excited when they see the cameras come out. And, you know, it's always a pleasure for me to come and visit with you guys. So it's a great deal that you have, and a great thing you guys do for high school sports and for the city and all the whole state.
So, you know, the first thing I go up, I read the scores, and I haven't even really. I get more of my feedback from Tom, because he's come out. He's a good friend. He's a good friend of all the baseball. He loves baseball.
Yeah.
And he even went to the softball games. He was keeping me up, because I took the week off. Not the week off. We had to do other things. Just. We did 84 games. We made some errors. I took the whole week with my staff, just working, you know, getting things worked out.
Yeah.
Good. So, he was keeping me up, but I go up in the stands on Saturday morning, and I go up, and I've got to know some of your parents, and also just friends of the program, and I go, it was funny. I go, well, how good are they? That's my first question. How good are they? And they're like, don't you know who we are? Wait, do you know what's happening? And I go, I deserved it. Yes, I took it like a man. I says, you know what? You're 100% right. I go, I'm asking you an honest question. I go,
no, and it's a legitimate one.
And here was the comment that was said, is that your bats were swinging. I mean, that was that's always good when the bats are swinging.
Yeah, you know I'd have no problem with your question, because I had some questions of my own going into the year, and I thought we'd have a chance to be pretty good. You know, my bit of a question mark was the pitching staff once you got past. You know, Jonathan and Devin. Mm-hmm. You know, I felt like we needed to.
You need that third guy. I mean, you got to have that third guy that's strong.
Right. And so when we've had a kid step up, Ben Schoenemann, who's a sophomore, he's really starting to step up, and he threw that game against Valley, and man, he was pitching his tail off. He gives up one run through six, and then there's five. And, you know, pitch counts early in the season. We're trying to hold him to about 75, and. He ended up getting to about 80, 79, 80, and so we had to make a move. And we go to the bullpen, and kid threw the ball well, but, you know, we made an error, and they put a couple base hits together, and they were able to take the lead in that inning. So, you know, but a legitimate question. The thing that I really like about this team is how well we're pitching. And then how well we're playing defense, because, you know, and I'm a firm believer, and I think there's a lot of people that would agree, is you know, in baseball, it's that pitching and defense, you know, that
and your bats are always, and your bats sometimes are not, and you can be hitting, and they could be hit hard. You could be that's one thing you don't control as a coach.
Yeah.
Your bats may not be getting the timely hits.
Exactly.
Or when your runners are in space. That I remember last year. I think it was last year with El Dorado. They could not get a timely hit, and then all of a sudden their bats came live at the end of the year.
Yeah. Right. Exactly.
That might have been 2 years ago. I'm just.
When they made their run to the state championship. Yeah. Exactly. Then you run into a tough pitcher. And you know, the old adage of good pitching beats good hitting. You know, especially with wood bats and high school kids, oftentimes tends to be true. So, you know, then you got to hope for that timely hit. And you know, when we've had a lot of success, we've inevitably been able to get that timely hit, and we try to
try. Most teams that win
exactly.
it have gotten that timely hit and move forward.
Yeah, exactly.
Or on a statement, two things: either a great defensive play or a great defensive mistake.
Right.
Those are two that. I mean, I'm getting good at this.
You are. You're picking it up.
You know, I analyze the games on even when the few that since I've been ousted by Tom.
Yes.
I'm third team. Okay, when I show up, I'm third team now.
Just keep hanging out with Greg, my
when I start analyzing the games and watching, I look at the pitching and then it's also is. And you made a great point. That's one thing they didn't talk about was your defense. I mean, but I look at that makes sense because I'm looking at these scores.
Right.
And there's some shutouts there.
Yeah, that's one of the things I think.
It's not all pitching either.
No, we've turned some pretty good defense. To this point, we've only made like 3 or 4 errors. And we're 9 games in. And I looked at our stats the other day. We're fielding something like 985 as a team, and that I haven't had at any level. A team that was that good defensively. Maybe 1 year when I was an assistant at UNM, I think we fielded pretty high level. But it's our infield defense, and our outfield defense. There aren't many balls that have been falling in the outfield, And with our infielders, if they can get to it, they're usually going to catch it and finish a play. So, that's the thing I look at, and one of the things that even though I'm an offensive guy, I look at the runs allowed. I mean, we've given up 9 runs through 9 games, and I think that is definitely a testament to
you gave
to
up
our,
5 in 1 game.
Yeah, we
so,
did.
So if you really break the other 8 games, I mean, you're like giving half a run per game.
Exactly. And then so that's the one thing, and we talk to the kids about, if they don't score, they can't win. And then we just got to get a timely hit here and there to add to a lead.
Well, something that maybe I haven't been out there, so before I make this time, be very, very careful more, but it seems like this year the weather's been extremely well. I mean, I looked at the elements for the Metro tournament. I looked state tournament basketball. It was like y'all were playing games then, and the week before that there was this maybe a little bit of bit of a deal, but I mean it's been like 75, 80 degrees, no wind.
I think the forecast
for this time of year, that's unbelievable.
Yeah, I think the forecast is scheduled to change a little bit at the end of this week. But yeah, our weather. I mean,
does that help on maybe your errors and things like that?
No, definitely.
I was going to bring that. I mean,
you tie that in, yeah, exactly. Because the one bad day that we've had weather wise was that February 28th. It was the opener against Valley. Like Rio Rancho canceled their game with El Dorado, I believe.
That's right.
And I thought somebody else canceled the game, but there was us and a few others that ended up playing. And yeah, those elements, and they actually helped us. It was pretty windy and it was a bit cold that day, but we got maybe a wind-aided home run in the first to take a 1-0 lead. But I wonder. 2 of the errors that we've made were in that game. One was a pickoff because of inexperience, I believe. And the other one was a ball we threw away off a bunt that I think probably had something to do with the elements, And so the hot start is probably attributed to the good weather and our kids are enjoying it, because even practice time February was unbelievable too. And I haven't looked at the field and how green the grass has gotten this quickly. It's usually not quite that green just yet. But it's been great weather.
No, and usually it hasn't. But I mean,
right?
And,
no,
I'm looking. I don't know that in the 9. Yeah, I've been really covering baseball in 9 years that I've seen weather this consistent.
Yeah, no, me neither. And this is my 8th season at La Cueva, and usually there's those cold, windy games in early March, and so far we haven't had that. And knock on wood, hopefully it stays that way.
Well, Jar, we're going to come back and talk about the Metro City Champions and how you got there.
Awesome.
Ladera Golf Course on Albuquerque's west side features spacious greens, 27 holes with outstanding practice facilities, and beautiful views of the Sandia Mountains. Nestled at the foot of the volcanoes, our 300-person banquet room and bridal suite is perfect for all occasions. Customize your room with color, chair covers, table linen, dinner, and champagne. Visit our cafe and bar with daily specials and happy hour, plus our full-service golf pro shop. For tee times and more information, call 505-836-4449.
The Barley Room, proud sponsor of ProView Networks for over 9 years, is pleased to introduce Black Iron Catering. From weddings and family reunions to birthdays and office parties, Black Iron Catering is perfect for any event. Contact Jamie at 505-459-8259 and book your event today. Black Iron Catering, let us bring our kitchen to you.
Terry Cosper Insurance Agency is a proud partner with ProView Networks and a proud supporter of New Mexico High School Athletics. Terry's been a local farmer's agent for over 20 years for auto, home, life, and business insurance. Just like high school sports are important, so are teen drivers. For more information, call Terry or one of his licensed staff members at 898-5556. Quotes are available for you. Gecko's Bar and Tapas, a proud supporter of ProView Networks. It's been a fan favorite spot for food lovers and sports fans. With not one, but two great locations, including outdoor patio, an atmosphere you won't want to miss. Gecko's, off Academy and in Knob Hill.
Folks, there's no other way but to be all in. Either he's Lord of all, or he is not Lord at all. And you can experience the real and authentic, true life change that only God can provide to humanity. See, when we truly encounter Jesus and purpose to know him and follow his teachings, hashtag life change will occur.
Sure, you could get him a new car. You could also light a pile of money on fire. So maintaining this old car is your best option. Keep it running longer, stronger, with quality parts and a whole lot of Napa know-how.
Don't forget, every ProView Network sporting event is on sale at our DVD store. Go to www.proviewnetworks.com to buy your DVD today.
I like that bat. I mean,
that
made my whole day. I mean, he's even making me look good, and that's hard to do. Okay, yeah. We know that's hard to do.
Yeah, but you and me both. It's better than that basketball bouncing around.
I know. That came out of nowhere. But that's the expectations. You know, you have expectations of players. You know, yeah. I have directors come up and they're always surprising me. Nice. And guess what? That just means more money. I mean, the bottom line with that is. But you have going into Metro tournament. Metro tournaments, I think, is really a big test early in the year. I mean, it's one. It's pride to let you know every team. You got Rio Rancho, Cleveland. You got all, and you come out number one, but. I'm gonna bring up a point, and I know this is. You had to play Sandia, and that was probably a big emotional game for you.
Yeah,
I want Coach John Gunther, ProView's condolences to the family. But from my part, what a great man! And still, I'll remember things that he did for me mm-hmm. for the rest of my life.
Yeah, you know, that it was definitely a sad day. And that
happened that day that y'all...
Yeah, we played him on Tuesday, and as far as I was told, I believe he passed on Wednesday morning. But, it was one of those things. I didn't know Coach Gunther all that well early when he first got that job, the head job there at Sandia. But, I grew to respect him. And
it's a rivalry. I mean,
we had some tough games.
And you hadn't had a great experience at Sandia, because I know I've sat out in right field or left field or whatever field, and we talked about why you're talking to me and not coaching the game. But you've had your moments.
Right.
Not the the best side of Girard has been at Sandia,
no,
right?
No. But John was that way. I mean, he brought out the best in his players and a lot of people, and you know, and he wanted what was best for his guys, and we were just trying to pay some tribute to him and his program, and so you know we put his initials behind home plate, and you know we had one of our booster club members say a little prayer, you know on his behalf, and you know and we are rivals, and at certain times there's you know, in all times the game means a lot at the moment, but there's much bigger things in life, and so you know we wanted to show a little bit of a sign of solidarity with Sandia, and so you know we alternated guys from both teams at near home plate for the prayer and then the national anthem, you know, before we played the game, and I think it was fitting because he's a good man, he was a good baseball man, and he only wanted what was best for his kids and his program, and you know, from what I understand, he was a heck of a math teacher, and so he had a lot of excellent qualities.
Well, what surprised me, it caught me way off guard, of course, and say if I'm selfish or my mindset, we were doing basketball, okay? And,
yeah.
And it was, I was at a basketball game, at a Sandia basketball game, and he came up and sat down and talked to me. It's like 6 weeks ago, I mean, 4 or 5 weeks.
Yeah.
Ago, just sitting and talked, and I said, how you doing? He said, it's tough. And then I heard that, and I was like, I didn't make time to go. But what was great, though, I think James Yotis said it best, or wrote the best thing was that I guess he had his whole family, and before he died, he said, this is awesome.
Yeah.
And everybody's had it. We've all experienced that at our age. We've been somewhere in our life. But to hear that, and then it's a big that he was going out content and happy.
Right. Well, and they say I hadn't seen him in obviously quite a while, but you know, up until a few weeks before his passing, they say that he was in good spirits. His mind was sharp.
That's why it just really, really caught me off guard. But I wanted to thank La Cueva for what they did that day. That you can't put a price tag on sportsmanship and really what we're all about, and that's just life and doing good, the right thing.
Right. I mean, I love what I do, and it's really important for me right now. But even with our kids, I try to press upon them about you know, the life's lessons. Is you know, it's great to be able to get to play this game, but you know, you need to learn from it too and take stuff that's going to help you later on, and because you're not going to get every job that you apply for, and you're, you know, somebody in your family is going to end up with some type of illness, and being able to have that perseverance to say, okay, you know, this isn't the best situation, this isn't the easiest situation, but you know, I'm going to fight through this and to make my life better and help my family. So, you know, the life lessons are, I think, one of our biggest jobs as coaches in those teaching moments, besides the skill stuff and the commitment to be successful. But, you know, learning life lessons is a big part of it for me.
And I think, well, you've been a player. You've had great coaches. You've had great mentors. But now it's... it's not like you're a young guy no more. Isn't that crazy? I mean, when you get the—I just remember you getting the job, and then we're talking, and the next thing you know, you're like it's yeah. 7 or 8. I can't even put a timetable since you've been, how long you've been at La Cueva. So
it's about 8th year.
Yeah, I was going to say 7 or 8 years, but it was like you were sitting there like when we first got it. You know, you win the state championship, and we were talking, and. I'm like, I've been doing this for 8, 9, 10 years too, and then it just seems like I just started. So,
well, I'm feeling the age, and I feel a lot older than what I am. But
you're smart.
Place.
I'm going to tell people that hey, this guy works out. He finally figured out that exercise and getting to the gym.
Oh yeah, I got to get back in there.
I was proud of you when I saw you a year
ago. Right. And
we were in there and then I'm going, who is this good-looking young guy? I didn't recognize him. So
yeah, I've been trying to do a little bit better, taking care of myself and running a little bit, and I've with the start of the season, and I've just kind of I've been off my routine there. I usually try to get, I'm big on routine.
Now I'm motivated. I want to probe you. I haven't seen you there, so I just say, you know what? And I know it's hard to get through the autograph session and get through all the things, but it was fun to see that you were actually sweating. I didn't, and in your workout, I even sped my deal up just a little bit, just where I could keep up with you. So.
Yeah, he's lying, folks.
But back to the Metro tournament, and we're gonna get to the final, Rio Rancho. You know, Josh can put up some highlights. I'll let you beat Adam Dill or Scott Galletti, and you can just play it by a play by seriously.
Oh, you know, those are some. I think that was a big strikeout in the second when he had runners on. You know, he made some big pitches when he really needed to get us out of innings. So, you know,
and here's those mental errors being on a miscue. This is probably your biggest inning right here.
Yeah, that one right there. Well, that double play to get out of that inning when he made that play and knocked the ball down and. Kid hit that ball hard and knocked his glove off, but you know, you see the emotion that we were able to play with. And that was a big run there too. You know, that was that two out run that, you know, we talk a lot about two out runs because they're such momentum boosters for us and momentum killers for the other team.
Well, I want to get back to that two-run thing, and I've been watching your team. I've scouted your team for 9 years, so I kind of have you have tendencies. So, but how great was that?
That's a great picture. I'm proud of our guys for playing hard all week and putting up some runs.
You know, back to the you made a comment, and you look at the history of La Cueva. Over 8 years now. Let's go back 8 years. I'm dating you now. I'm not going to do it, but 8 years is that how many two out runs have y'all had rallies? I mean, I remember doing games, and I'm saying, I made these statements. I mean, this ain't good. They're two outs and there's one guy on base and this could be a long and sure enough, you guys go score 5, 6, 7 runs with two outs.
Yeah,
I never asked you about that, but you preach that.
Well,
or you got it in your mindset.
I think it is a mentality. You know, we tell our guys that. Well, you'll hear me at time to time say two out hits win games, and it might be in the third inning, and it, you know, as we've had a couple times, it might be in seventh or extra innings. But you know, you get those two out hits, right? Teams on the verge of feeling like they're getting out of an inning, you know, unscathed, and then you can clutch up and find that hole and get that two out hit, and you can see the wind just go completely out of their sails. Yeah, I think it was like 2010. Well, 2010, 2011, those first two championship years. I mean, we were down to our last out definitely against Oñate in 2010. And against El Dorado, well, Kogan hit that leadoff home run to tie it in the seventh. But, you know, we've been down a run late in games. You know, with the season on the brink and been able to find a way. And, you know, I definitely feel like it's a mentality, and I think it's hopefully something that I feel this team has. And, you know, we've had a couple teams that didn't quite have that. You know, so it's cyclical to a certain extent, but I do think it is something that we try to preach to them and instill in them.
Because, I mean, you do, because they've executed. I mean, even like when I see coaches call timeout, and I always say, we'll see what kind of how the kids respond to your timeout. Mm-hmm. or your reaction. If a good play happens, and you know, I always go relate back to basketball, but it's every sport. You know, you call a timeout, you bring the kids in, you talk to them. And in basketball, it's usually because the other team's having a run. And,
right.
Okay. And then you need a basket. You're calling the timeout to run a play. And I always say, if you go execute on, you know, then that coach, it's even though he may get beat this game, but he knows that his guys are listening to him, and good things are going to happen during the year.
Right, you know, and so a lot of that, those runs in basketball, and we talk a lot about momentum. You know, and so it happened on Saturday when we were up, I think we were up 4-0, and we gave up that run in the fifth or the sixth. You know, and so one of the key moments in that game, I felt, was when we came back in the bottom of the inning and scored. You know, and so we pushed the lead back up to 4, you know, and you just make their job tougher. And so we try to do that and preach that as well, is trying to keep the momentum on our side, whether it's even if we give up a couple runs, is, you know, we don't have to go and score, match the number of runs that they scored. We just need to score to cut into their momentum, because, you know, they put up a 0, and now their momentum tends to build, and you give them some hope, and they start to feed off of that. So, yeah, I totally agree. And some of the timeouts that I'll call are to stall momentum. You know, when we make a mound visit, would be to try to kind of even things out a little bit there emotionally, and get our guys back in a good frame of mind.
Well, Gerard, we're going to come back, and we're going to talk about the overall baseball world in high school.
I'm loving it.
At Extreme Clean, we understand your home is your most important investment. From carpet to tile and grout cleaning, we handle it all. Call Extreme Clean now to schedule 221-6440, extremecleannm.com.
Sinners and Saints, a proud sponsor of Pro View Sports and New Mexico Youth Athletics. Start your evening off right with a delicious menu selection like the Sinner's Smothered Fries with pulled pork and green chili, always prepared with fresh, never frozen ingredients. Catch all the sports action from college pros and MMA on 35 HD TVs. Sinners and Saints, the friendliest sports bar in Albuquerque.
Sadie's is a proud supporter of New Mexico High School Sports and Athletics, and we here at ProView Networks would like to thank Sadie's for their continued support in helping us bring you all of your New Mexico High School sports coverage.
Visit the Frontier Restaurant. Due to heavy construction on Central, take lead or coal coming north or south. The Frontier Restaurant. Get your Frontier fix on.
Altitude Sports Grill is where Albuquerque's sports fans won't miss a game. With locally crafted brews on tap and refreshingly crisp cocktails. Located in Hotel Cascada, Albuquerque residents find a staycation worth staying for. Catching Lobo Sports, enjoying a beer on the beach, or wiping out, Hotel Cascada is home to your urban adventure. Affordable guest rooms, no-hassle water park parties, and much more.
Graphic Connection is your source for quality custom sports apparel inspired by the athletes that wear it. Graphic Connection offers in-house graphics, embroidery, digital printing, and screen printing, enabling us to offer custom products with fast turnaround to suit both your budget and your timeline. Graphic Connection is New Mexico's exclusive Cornette digital garment printer shop. The print resolution is unparalleled. Contact Graphic Connection today at 505-821-2777 or visit us online at www.gcsportswear.com.
Ladera Golf Course on Albuquerque's west side features spacious greens, 27 holes with outstanding practice facilities, and beautiful views of the Sandia Mountains. Nestled at the foot of the volcanoes, our 300-person banquet room and bridal suite is perfect for all occasions. Customize your room with color, chair covers, table linen, dinner, and champagne. Visit our cafe and bar with daily specials and happy hour, plus our full-service golf pro shop. For tee times and more information, call 505-836-4449.
Hey, welcome back to Steve Davis Show. I have Coach Gerard Panetta, head baseball coach of La Cueva here, and Gerard, you know, like my show, it goes by quick. Your season's going by quick, and I just kind of. We'll just kind of go down and see, and I'll put you on the spot a little bit, and you can kind of tell me what you do know. And I know you well enough to know that you take one game at a time, but on the backside of it, you're always listening to see what the El Dorados, Manzanos, and Sandias are doing, even though you played the Sandia, but you're always, you're just kind of keeping in touch. And right now, Max Preps has got you down as number one, which deservedly so, maybe. You're 8-1, 8-game winning streak, best in the state. But one that's really intrigued me, Atrisco Heritage. I mean, I'm not. That's one that I'm not used to seeing. Number two.
Well, we have those guys next week, a week from tomorrow, and they've got a couple pitchers, so that's not totally surprising to me.
I know they have a good. Adrian Ortega does a great job as an athletic director.
Right.
The principal, the whole dynamics of that school is sports driven. Similar to La Cueva.
Their head coach, Chris Shahiro, he's got a good track record, and he's got a solid foundation, from baseball standpoint. And excuse me, he's got those guys ready, and they're playing well, and they're a good club, and so that's definitely another one. Similar to our approach to Valley is we're going to go in there and expect to win, but you got to know in the back of your mind that there's a chance those guys could step up and beat you, and if you give them any openings, that just might happen. So, just like every game, we got to step on the field, be ready to play, and be prepared, and we'll let the rankings and those things kind of take care of themselves.
And I'm just doing this because I wanted to kind of get a feedback. Since most people have been watching basketball. No pun intended there or anything like that. But I'm just saying now it's baseball season. But it's amazing how it changes. I mean, and everybody gears up for the next, and you said it earlier, it's like, hey, when it comes baseball time, we're ProView Networks is there.
Right, exactly. You can even break the season into phases, however you want to do it. And that Metro and then the tournament season kind of that we're in now is big because it gives you a chance to simulate to a certain degree what the state tournament is going to be like playing. You don't know who you're playing the next round. You know it's one of two teams and getting you ready for that. And now we're about a week and a half away from district, which is going to be another important part of that seeding and selection portion. And even when I've glanced at the rankings and the standing statewide, I've kind of noticed and been intrigued how much they've kind of fluctuated too. Where Cleveland jumps out to that unbeaten start, and then goes and faces a tough Carlsbad team. To Rio Rancho, kind of having the best record, and Carlsbad was up there. And the team that we haven't mentioned today, and he's going to have his guys ready for sure, and he plays such a tough schedule, is Piedra Vista. Now that they're 6A,
I was going to bring that. That was something I was going to bring up too.
That's so fun, and Mike and I get along really, really well. We have a great friendship.
They have a history of winning. Face it, it's unbelievable what they've done in 5A for the last 10 years. So.
Going back to what you were talking about earlier about how, that's a guy who's definitely not afraid to drop a game. And evident by his schedule, he goes and he's fortunate in my mind that he gets to set his own schedule because,
That's a disadvantage, picks, really, to
well, you know, new. Well, in APS, we have the city and budget restrictions and everything like that. I totally understand where they're coming from, but, it would be nice to be able to say, hey, I want to play those guys. Because I don't think we'd shy away from anybody, playing anybody anytime. But in fact, Coach McGaha's got his guys out in Phoenix playing in a very prestigious tournament and a tough tournament. I think we scrimmaged them in February, and he's got a couple pretty good arms, and he's got an offense that can beat you and score runs at any given moment. So. The state tournament will be fun to see and fun to watch because there's between some of the big arms that are out there.
Well, let's talk about it. We got Carlsbad. They're number three, and I think you talk about big arms, maybe the biggest arm.
Oh, yeah.
And eyeballs. I mean, what I understand, there's 30 to 40 scouts, and they're like picking their dates to come in and watch this young man.
Literally and figuratively, he's 6'6", a big arm. But, You know, and he's, from the accounts that I've heard, his velocity's really good, and he's throwing second pitches for strikes and third pitches, and, you know, keeping him healthy, he's going to make quite a bit of money come June, and deservedly so. And, you know, you've got him, and he's not their only arm either. They've got a couple other guys.
And I think that's a big, you know, I was kind of surprised that, you know, that they've lost three games or so, you know, on their overall record. I'm looking at this, if I can read it correctly, you know, they played 14 games.
Right. You know,
they have a little bit of advantage because they play more games
early.
And,
you know, those three losses, I mean, one's to Cleveland, which is a very good team. Another one's to Piedra Vista, and they played Piedra Vista twice that one weekend, on a Thursday and a Saturday. And I think Piedra Vista beat them one on Thursday, 5-1, and Carlsbad came back in the game that Rogers pitched and beat them 3-0, beat Piedra Vista 3-0. And then their other one is a district game in a doubleheader where they split a doubleheader with Mayfield, I believe. So, you know, that's a very good team right there.
Team maybe you're really familiar, Las Cruces. I mean.
Yeah.
And it's kind of, I'm looking at this top four, you know, and Las Cruces is usually not in one of those. I mean, they've always been a team that always comes through at the end of the year.
Yeah, you know, I love playing Gil. We played Oñate this year, but, you know, Gil and I try to get on each other's schedule as often as we can. We've only played each other, I think, twice. But, you know, they've got another really good arm as a junior, Tristan Lively. You know, so you get out there and you got a good arm, you got a good shot to beat anybody. So, you know, again, that one's not surprising to me either, that they're playing well and beating some people.
Well, here's the one you just already kind of, Pedro Vista. I mean, they're in the top five. I mean, you know, I guess they're moving up in the ranks or whatever, because they're not on the radar because they're in the top five. So.
Well, you know, I think everybody's kind of still getting a little bit used to them being 6A. You know, we've scrimmaged Coach McGaha and his team every year for the last several, and you know, and they even actually come down here and play. We play a fall scrimmage against each other. So we've gotten to know him pretty well, and he's gotten to know our guys pretty well. And, you know, I really like the way he runs his program, and, you know, he and I chat fairly often and pick each other's brain. And, you know, so I think that's definitely somebody, you know, that some people are going to have to watch out for.
Kind of watch out and see how they do in that district. And then here's, you know, then Cleveland, you know, that it's Cleveland, what, you know, you better be aware of them.
I mean, he's
every year he keeps knocking on the door.
Yeah, Shane and I go way back. We played junior college baseball together. Excuse me, but, you know, they've got a big arm. Jack Morano's a junior. I guess he's committed to UNM already. You know, so again, you talk about that guy that's at upper 80s, maybe touching 90 guy that seems like a lot of people have. Cibola has one. You know, the kid from Rio Rancho was throwing the ball really well. You know, the big righty they brought in on Saturday. So, you know, everybody's got like one really good guy, it seems like, and, you know, then there's another group of people who have another two or three guys that are quality pitchers that give you a chance to win. So, yeah, the state tournament and then with the pitch counts is going to be an interesting 3 days, I believe.
Well, one more. We're about to run out of time. Santa Fe is kind of a surprise. I mean, I don't know if I'm just
– Yeah.
And Clovis. I mean, we got very little time. And then your one of your district is El Dorado, and I think when it comes to rivalry games, El Dorado, there's no bigger than that.
I agree. So we're going to take a look at Santa Fe.
A little bit difference in dynamically of who the top teams are in the state.
So. Yeah, it was interesting when I was looking at that too. So, you know, you mentioned Santa Fe and Clovis, who are district rivals or district opponents for us now. You know, fortunately, they're both in Rio Rancho's tournament this week, so. Yeah, so we'll get our eyes on them.
We'll be right there. You can actually watch it on ProView. But
I'll come say hi.
Hey, you might even come in and talk a little bit. But, Coach, I want to thanks for coming on. Congratulations on the Metro Champion 2017 Metro Championship, and good luck to you in the rest of the season. But most of all, thanks for just coming on and hanging out with Steve Davis.
Well, I appreciate it. I could do this all day.
All right, appreciate it, man.
Thank you.